So work. This will be a kind of a mixture of slides and demonstration. I hope it won't crash. Layout is very rough at the moment, so it's half the time it'll crash. I can get what I want done, but we'll see. I'll just jump right in and talk about the easiest to use, most adaptable user interface in the universe. So I speak, of course, of this, a blank piece of paper. This is kind of where I get my inspiration for how I'm attempting to design the interface for Laidout, which is kind of a desktop publishing program that I wrote to basically help me make my cartoon books, which involves importing a ton of images and laying them out into various impositions. So the pros of a blank piece of paper is that it's multi-contact, it's pressure-sensitive, color-managed, real-world brush dynamics, minimal tool clutter. Of course, that depends on what pens you've got in your pocket or whatever. But Undo is only partially implemented, though, so there's work to be done. So here's an example of what can be done just on paper. You don't necessarily need Undo. I've been drawing all my life, and a lot of artists who are just trained to do work just with pigments and stuff. The idea is just if you do something that you want to undo, you shouldn't have done it that way in the first place. It's just a habit. So like you can see an example of pressure sensitivity and varying line width depending on pressure. Yeah, you can kind of see up there, I think. This is how I used to design or lay out cartoon books. So for instance, here's one book. This was I've done with laid out, but it's on legal sized paper. It's just a ton of images laid out into a folded booklet. So before, I just draw little boxes. So the one in the top is the front cover, and then the next spread, inside cover, first page, blah, 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 all the way. So then I'd have to write in or draw in little thumbnails for each of the little cartoons that are on each page, which as long as if you stick to the maxim that you're only supposed to do it right the first time, it goes just great, but it doesn't always work that way. So if I want to rearrange cartoons or whatnot, then I'd have to erase the cartoons and draw them in the margin and figure out where it's going to go and then redraw them. That's kind of a pain. So I begin to look for solutions to how to do this on the computer. Here's me in my natural environment with various books and such. The Stumptown Comics Fest in the United States. So generally the process involved is you make content. For me, that's typically on paper. Then I scan it in. It's simple images. For the future, I want to be able to do more dynamic images. For instance, Scribus render frames, it's something that the program cannot automatically do, but something else can do it. It's convenient to just say to that other thing, do this, and then drag that thing in. Typically, my stuff is black and white, so I haven't really needed color management so much, but are there any Huygen developers here today? It's because of them that I haven't worked on layout so much, because I've been kind of obsessed with making spherical panoramas. So I've got like 100 panoramas that are all color. It would be nice to do something with color management, color managed books or whatnot, cutouts. So the next step for laying out is to lay them all out into spreads. The imposition is definitely something that's instrumental from the beginning of a project. It's not something that you just, or for me anyway, convert into. It's not something you do after the fact. It's something that's determines page count and what goes next to each other. That's very important right from the beginning. Then once you have everything laid out, you want to print it out or to paper, or sometimes to fabric, because say you have a shirt that has strange seams or something, the fashion thing, that sounded kind of neat. Something laid out can do, just thinking about impositions, how do you determine what page goes next to each other? Well, why stick to books? I mean, you can just make that any sort of, any polyhedron, any bizarre shape that you can imagine with things next to each other. That's, as far as I'm concerned, within the realm of laid out. Some people call it packaging. It's arbitrary polyhedral surfaces. There's other stuff that you can put in after that, like other fluff, like gradients, lines, text, all that other stuff. right. I tend to draw all my text, so it hasn't been a priority. When people ask me to do things, they always want text, and I always refer them to Scrivus or I guess Scribus. Let's see. When I was trying to find other software to do these things, Scrivus was okay for text, but not so great for lots of images. Inkscape was awesome with pass. You can do tons of stuff with it. Importing multiple images, like often I'll have 40 pages of cartoons or 100 pages of cartoons, and doing that is not so easy with anything else that I found. Inkscape has no multi-page at the moment. Perhaps after SVG 1.2 gets finalized, perhaps that will become important. Podofu and Prose and KPrinter and all that stuff, those are imposition solutions kind of after the fact. I don't know if anyone's seen Easy Pose. It appeared a year or two ago and disappeared a year or two ago. But that way of doing imposition seemed awesome, because you can just take one piece of paper and then fold it, and then fold it again and fold it again, and the computer keeps track of how the pages will be arranged. So you just do all these folds on screen. It's very easy to do. So let's see if I can make this thing work. It was there yesterday. Oh, there it is. So this is just kind of a quick demonstration of how I would lay out a cartoon book. So I want to do a letters, legal size paper and landscape as a booklet. You can put in margins if you want. I try as much as possible to make tools that everything happens on the canvas. So far, what does not do that is my image import, which it's this huge, cumbersome dialogue, but it sort of gets the job done. I'm working on a replacement to have some of the features of the InDesign place tool, so you can drag out things. But for me, the automated import is extremely important, because you don't want to do exactly the same sort of process for 40 images. It's better just to define sort of a template of where things are supposed to go on the page and then just dump in a whole bunch of stuff. So some of you might recognize that as the lobby to the Pantone Motel. Either that or the Chicago Airport. So now I've selected about 20 images or so. I can specify what DPI you want to import it as. There's options to select or import only a certain number per page, or you can do all the images as will fit on the page, so it'll just kind of do it by rows, or you can slap them all into a single page. There will eventually be more options to lay them out in particular patterns and whatnot, but I'm working on it. There's only so much time, and I'd rather be drawing cartoons, but I do what I can. So that's a spherical panorama done in Huygen. So some of these images are a little bit too big. And using a combination of mouse clicks and holding like the control key down, I can scale it, or if I do control and shift and then drag the mouse around, I can rotate it. There's also ways to shear it. It's hard to do while holding a microphone and do that, I just discovered. So these are all the spreads. Similar sort of thing. And then I would just export it to whatever PDF or whatever is easiest to print at the moment. Then the export can go to a single PDF, because that has multi-page, but say you want to export all the page spreads into SVG, because maybe that's easier to manipulate for some reason, then you can do that also, except it'll make just a whole bunch of numbered SVG files. If for batch processing, that can be extremely useful. Okay, I wanted to find a sort of empty page. And here's a gradient. Gradients in laid out are objects in themselves. They're not fill properties or anything like that. I just think of them as just blocks of color. Like if you're painting, you lay out a block of color, it just sort of makes more sense to me. So you can add different color spots or stops. Oops. You can drag these things around just right on screen. It's very, very easy to do. You can select multiples and drag those multiples around. You can also do it for radial gradients, but for some reason, that was not working last night, but now it's working. So you can adjust the circles of gradients. And also when I started to develop laid out, I noticed that in the PDF spec, that it gives you all the math that you need for mesh gradients. So I thought, what the hell, that's pretty neat. So see if this works now. So this can do mesh gradients. But it is true that mesh gradients are, to really do anything useful with them, it takes a lot of time and you have to mess around with all these little points. It's very cumbersome. The diffusion curves sound very interesting. Yeah, I should have thought about this before. It's much harder holding a microphone and demonstrating that.
Just put it aside.
Okay. Now, assuming it doesn't crash, then perhaps I can. Oops. I've been redoing the interface with Xlib, so now some of the things that used to work don't quite work. I'm using Xinput to use multiple mice to do tricks like the double scrolling and stuff like that, but I didn't quite get that done before today. So you can select points like that and rotate them around and do that sort of thing. Yeah, I've wasted hours just goofing around with psychedelic effects like that. And you can select and drag edges to conveniently add more pieces to it, or you can move this around and select where you want to subdivide patches. But it gets progressively more painful to really make anything useful with this, unless you do it right the first time. But it's still very hard to do. Then once you have the mesh controls, you can adapt it to images also. Let's see if this works. So instead of having a color field as your color source, you can have an image as your source. So this was an image, by the way, that was, and all my photography I processed with the GIMP, so it's good job. So I can do most of what I want with it. So you can all do all sorts of bizarre distortions. I'd kind of like to have this sort of thing as a tool in the GIMP. I keep meaning to try to write something like that, but it's spherical panoramas, it just eats up all my time. So that's my basic object demo. So for the, I want the future of impositioning. So there will be three different basic kinds of impositions. One is the in signatures, where first you take a piece of paper, then chop it into sections, and then take those sections and fold it in any way that you want. That's a pretty traditional way of making signatures. And then you can do trim, select a binding edge. So if you want to do images, or I mean book sets, are like the Western style page one, where the binding is on the left side, you fold it a particular way. If you want the binding on the other side for Japanese or whatever, you just fold it in such a way and assign the binding so it's on the other side. The next kind of net is just with some sort of polyhedron or a box or whatnot. So I'm still in the process of making it so that you can easily unwrap such things. I've been trying to figure out how to import Scribus documents. So when you view those, everything is in this giant scratch space, as far as I can tell. And it's just one giant spread, and the overlap between pages is dependent on that. And I don't see an adequate way to make that into any of the first two. So most likely there will be a free imposition, which is more adaptable. One page equals one particular type of paper. You can also override what type of paper or how it gets printed on papers. So say you have one image and you want to spread it across like 10 different pieces of paper, then you can plop down papers underneath it, under any spread view, any object view. Just put any number of papers behind it and makes it easy. There's lots of new like homemade user interfaces being developed by particularly nuigroup.com or Wii remotes to do wacky things or MIDI devices. That's something I'm definitely trying to implement into Laidout, just to be able to move things around in strange ways that it's hard to do. So you can do everything with hand waving eventually. I think that would be kind of cool. I'm also trying to make Laidout in such a way that it cooperates with other programs as easily as possible. So software engines, that's the way to go. No one program is going to do everything that you want it to do. So like say you want text in Scribus or paths in Inkscape or like painting with MyPaint, then it would be convenient to be able to just send that layer to some other program, have it worked on, and then have it be automatically updated, for instance, in that original program. For Laidout, the unique features, I suppose, at the moment are meshes and the impositioning. So I'm trying to make it easy to access the impositioning features from other programs. So speaking of interoperability, it's good to have nice documentation. In Laidout, you can dump out a description of what the file format actually is if you want to write importers, for instance. That I wouldn't recommend that, however, because the file format is extremely unstable, like many things in Laidout. But should you want to experiment just because you're a masochist, then you can do Laidout file format and get something sort of useful. The Scribus importer in Laidout, it doesn't understand text, but it does import those blocks as mystery data. I don't think I'll do the mystery data demo. It's just like a block that has question marks that kind of bounce around as you move. And then when you export it, it sort of remembers what the data was. So I've done some tests where importing a Scribus document, reimposing, and then exporting, and then going back in Scribus and tweaking, and it seems to work for printing booklets, which is a very commonly asked for thing. Let's see, and there is, I hope I have time for one more demo. Okay, so can you still hear me? So this is a something that I use for projecting panoramas. For instance, this was that ball. So it's a panorama. This is actually a polyhedral shape that has about 300 sides in it with a polyhedra projected onto it. It's basically globe gores, just slivers glued onto a ball. So I use this to figure out or to unwrap things onto it. So if you can just do this and then unwrap a shape pretty easily. So this, for instance, is Lick Observatory in California. It's this giant telescope. You'll notice this artifact here. That's just because it was hot and the roof was melting. So now you can take this, whatever shape you have, and move your image around, rotate, things like that. So here's the globe. One easy way to unwrap, you can just do this. That's it.
So two questions, what toolkit are you using for these applications? Because this doesn't look very familiar to me.
I made my own. So. It's partly when I first started this was like 5 years ago, I had like no programming experience in Linux at all. So I thought, oh, what the hell, I'll just figure it out myself. It's probably just as quick to make my own as to figure one of these other ones out. In retrospect, I think that's been totally wrong. But I have learned a lot. It's at least better than it used to be. If you want to implement multi-touch stuff, that's still kind of going along a little slowly for the major toolkits. Whereas in mine, I can just hunker down for a month or so and then make it. So it's freedom, I suppose. No one else uses it, so I mean, I don't have to worry about screwing up anyone else, so it's convenient.
A second question and the last one. Well, let's take three.
Some work you might have seen it about unwrapping. The examples were basically globes where you have. Unfortunately, I don't really recall the exact name, but it was like subdividing the globe into lots of small triangles and then taking into account the pattern of the globe itself, so that you have the continents sticking together or taking, for example, the rivers as potential breaks between the things. Mm-hmm. I found that quite interesting. Do you think, do you know this or are you interested in this? And second, do you think you might be interested in doing something similar?
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But it's still a very flat way of projecting. So if you were to project it and then print it out, for instance, there is just a million little cuts. My interest is primarily for making stuff you can actually physically create, but theoretically stuff like that is pretty neat. You can make some pretty interesting images with that. There's one Flickr group called Foldables, where there's a few people that have been working in or trying to figure out really wacky projections. So it's things like that and other strange curvy surfaces. It's in a similar sort of vein.
Okay, the bonus question.
Not exactly a question, more of a request. Unwrap it again.
Well, I'd have to warn you, that's frequently when I try to unwrap giant shapes like this, it kind of does peculiar things.
Oh. Yep.